Hello everyone, thanks for watching Edupedia World videos. I am Neeti Saxena and I'll be taking the subject Principles and Practices of Management. This is part 2 of module 4. We've already covered part 1 in our previous video wherein I had described the basic concept of organizing, organization structure and organization design. And this is the part 2 wherein we would be covering what is the organization structure, how is it developed, what is departmentalization, span of control, authority, delegation of authority, and some more principles related to all this. In the next video that you would be watching of this particular module, you'll be covering the different types of organization structure that are prevailing in today's corporate environment. So when we talk about the organization structure, an organization structure is a set of planned relationships. See, very important, these are planned relationships between groups of related functions and between physical factors and personal requirement required for the performance of the function. So what is basically happening is that in the organization, if you know that these are the different functions that has to be performed in the organization, then you can group these functions into different departments, and that is called as an organization structure. In every department, you have further hierarchy which is to be followed, and which also demarcates a proper communication channel within the department and between the departments. The organization structure is generally shown in the form of an organization chart, which looks like this. The organization chart, you can see there's a chairman, vice chairman reports to the chairman. Then under the vice chairman, there are various different departments. Under every department, you have sub departments then. So this is how an organization structure looks like, and this the presentation of the organization structure in this form is called as an organization chart. Now, going back to the previous slide, the last bullet point was left, which is it shows the authority and responsibility relationships between the various positions in the enterprise by showing who reports to whom. See, if we look into this particular chart, we can see that starting from the bottom, quality control, quality assurance, these are two sub-departments of quality department. Similarly, recruitment and evaluation are two sub-departments of the HR department. You can see civil engineering, metal engineering, electromechanical engineering are sub-department of the construction department. So what is happening is that people of these sub-departments are reporting to the head of the departments. Head of the department is further reporting to the vice chairman, and vice chairman is reporting to the chairman. So when you are describing the organization structure of an organization, you are clearly demarcating and showing the hierarchy of the organization, the reporting structure of the organization, and the communication channel of the organization. So this is very, very important, because when we talk about the primitive organizations, there was no proper organization structure. Because of it, there was a lot of chaos. Nobody knew what are the responsibilities and authorities assigned to them. There was a lot of duplication of work, because two people were doing the same work. They were not told what exactly they were supposed to do. So to eradicate all certain such lacunas which were there in the organization, the organization chart and organization structure are being made in today's organizations, because of which there is very much clarity of roles, there is clarity of responsibility, there is no ambiguity, and of course the work is done very smoothly. Now, what is the importance of organization structure? It facilitates administration, because when every person is assigned certain duties, certain responsibilities, certain authorities, and the structure and hierarchy, everything is defined, then of course administrating it becomes very easy. It promotes growth and diversification. Coordination becomes easy. Optimum use of human resource and training and development also becomes very, very easy. Now, coming into types of organization structure, there can be two types of organization structure broadly. One is a flat structure and the other one is a tall structure. There are two words which have been used in this slide, a span of control and scalar chain. I will describe these words in the later in the video. As of now, just try to understand what is a flat structure and a tall structure. See, this is a flat organization structure wherein you do not have lot of hierarchies. You know, see, characteristic of decentralized companies with relatively few layers of management and relatively wide span of control. What is happening here is that you can see that the hierarchy is not very tall. It is just three layers: associate, partners, and chief partner. There are not much people who are involved at different levels of the hierarchy. So this is called as a flat structure wherein lot of power is decentralized to people. See, associates have a lot of power to take decisions. Partner definitely has more power than the associates, and chief partner, of course, is the head of the organization. So there is a lot of decentralization of power. Power is not accumulated to the chief partner. Power is decentralized even to the associates. When we say the wide span of control is how many people are reporting to you. So when we talk about partner, can you see there are only three partners, and to every partner there are four people reporting. So the span of control is more. In case if we remove one more partner and there is only two partners left, then to every partner there would be six people reporting. So your span of control would be wider. So span of control is basically how many people are reporting to you. So when we talk about a flat organization structure, the span of control of the manager is high because there are more number of people who are reporting to the manager. Now this type of organization is possible only where even the lower level employees are very well trained. Because just think, if there are 100 employees who are reporting to one particular manager, then of course the manager will be able to control these 100 employees only when these 100 employees are very well trained. In case if they are not trained, then you need to have a tall hierarchy. Now what is a tall hierarchy? See, the way you have an army. In army, you have a soldier, you have Nayak, Subedar, Major, Captain, Lieutenant, Major, Colonel, Brigadier, and many more. Some of the ranks I haven't even shown in this particular slide. So you can see that the hierarchy is very, very tall. There are a lot of levels. Now, when we talk about the soldier does not have any kind of power of decision making. Similarly, Nayak also doesn't have, but comparatively a little more. Majorly, the decision-making powers are maximum given to the captain and lieutenant, not below that. So what are we trying to say? That this is a kind of a centralized organization. The power is centralized. The power is given to the general, brigadier, maximum to the colonel, little less to the major. So, and the span of control is also narrow. Why narrow? Because there are less people who are reporting to one particular person. This is called as a tall hierarchy. Tall hierarchy is usually used in certain organizations wherein you are not very sure of that, you know, how your lower level employees are very well trained or not. If we go through the slide, we can see tall organization structure. It is also called as vertical structure. Characteristics of centralized companies with multiple layer of management and relatively narrow span of control. I hope these two concepts are clear to you. I would like to repeat it once again. Flat organization structure and tall. In flat organization, the span of control is wide. Why wide? Because more number of people are reporting to one person. Tall organization structure, the number of people reporting to one person is less. So of course, the span of control is narrow. I hope these things are clear to you. Steps in organizing. There are various different steps in organizing which the management has to follow. First is determination of objectives. Second is division of activities, creating and grouping of jobs, assignment of jobs, creation of managerial hierarchy, and establishing integration mechanism. Now let's just go through these steps one by one. First is determination of objective. First of all, majorly, the objective of the organization should be very, very clear to the management. Once you are clear with the objective, you will be able to understand what are the different activities and functions that need to be carried in the organization. So first of all, of course, the determination of objective is very, very important. Once the objective is clear, you need to decide what are the different activities that are to be performed in the organization and how are these activities to be categorized into different departments. So division of activity is important. Division of activity also incorporates creating and grouping of jobs. For example, in a manufacturing company, you know that you have to purchase resources, you have to utilize those resources. There's proper manufacturing methodology which the organization follows. So there is a product line through which the product goes, and finally the product is produced. Then it is marketing of the product, selling of the product. At the same time, there is a finance department which controls every little finance of the company, every transaction of the company. There's an accounts department. So a lot of things are there in every organization. So the manager or the head of the organization has to understand what are all those different activities that needs to be done. And then similar activities are grouped. So that is creating and grouping of jobs. Assignment of group of jobs is basically that you then assign these jobs to different departments. You assign HR jobs to HR department, finance to finance, accounts to accounts, marketing to marketing, and then creation of managerial hierarchy. You understand that there's an HR department. You would look into it that how many HR people do we want? Maybe we want 10 people, we want 6 people. In case if we have 6 people, what is the hierarchy that we need to establish? Who is reporting to whom? In these 6 people, who would be doing recruitment, who would be looking into training, who would be looking into performance appraisal? So everything is divided and a proper managerial hierarchy is then established. And of course, the last is establishing integration mechanism, that when the different departments are formed, there is a communication channel which is made between the departments also. Because if there is a sales department, the sales department definitely needs to communicate to the operation department that this is the number of products or this is the further production that is required. And so all these things are very, very important. So when we talk about responsibility and authority and accountability, these are three different words. Responsibility is when a task is given to a person, he or she becomes responsible and accountable for it. That means that work has to be performed by that person and the accountability of getting that work done is to that person. And with responsibility and accountability, of course, the organization needs to give some kind of authority to that person so that that person can take decisions related to that particular work. Principle of functional definition. Again, there are certain things which we need to understand. Clear authority is very much important. Why is it important? Because if in case clear authority and clear task responsibility is not given, then there will be ambiguity in the organization. So see, formal and legitimate right of a manager to make decision and issue orders. There is a difference between power and authority. Power is something which anybody can have, but authority comes with position. So authority is something which comes with position. So formal and legitimate right of a manager to make decision and issuing orders is something which is called as authority. With every position, if you give certain powers to a person, then that big power becomes a legitimate power, which is called as an authority. It defines line. You know, when we talk about authority, there are two types of authority: line authority and staff authority. Line authority is with the line manager, staff authority is with the staff managers. Now, who are these line managers and staff managers? Staff managers are the people who make certain rules and regulations which help the line managers to perform their duty. And line managers are the people who are actually getting the work done from the lower level people. So line managers get the work done, and staff managers are the people who help making the rules so that the line managers can follow those rules and get the work done from people. Line authority: individuals in management positions have the formal power to direct and control immediate subordinates. They have direct responsibility for the production of goods and services. Staff authority: granted to staff specialists in the area of expertise. Authority is distinguished by three characteristics. Authority is vested in organizational positions and not people. Authority is accepted by subordinates. Authority flows down the vertical hierarchy. So when we are talking about these three lines, these are very important. It talks about authority is vested in organization position. With the position, the authority comes. Power can be with anyone. Even the when you talk about these militants, even they have a power. But then that is not the legitimate power. Legitimate power comes with the position. The prime minister of a country has a legitimate power because he is being given those powers because of the position. So also in the organizations, because of the positions that you hold, you have been given an authority. Authority is accepted by subordinates. Why? Because when the authority is coming because of the position, of course the subordinates have to accept that authority. And it flows down the vertical hierarchy. Types of organizational relationship, this is something that we've already covered, the line relation and staff relation. Line relation is what I've told you, is when the employees get work done from the subordinates. Staff relation is just assisting, advising, making policies. So let me just go through this slide for you. Line relation presents levels of hierarchy, superior subordinate relationships, and provides the framework for the organization. It is shown by a solid line in the organization chart. See, here you can see the solid lines. These solid lines are the line authority. Okay. Now let's go to the staff relation. It has no command. Personnel have only the right to advise, assist, and support those in the line authority and the performance of their duties. It is shown by the dotted line. Here you can see the between the different positions, you can see that there is a dotted red line. This is something which is called as the staff relationship. So these people, they do not have a authority to, you know, to get work done from the other people, but it is just that they can advise. So that is called as a staff relationship. The solid line is which shows that these people are getting the work done from the subordinates. So they have the proper line authority. Now when we talk about departmentalization, is something, you know, you understand what is departmentalization, that the work is being divided into different departments or different divisions, and every division and every department, they perform their own work. Now this departmentalization can be based on many different things, based on services, based on function, based on location, based on the patient. Now what happens is that patient here is basically the customer. And this is something that I would advise you that you should look into the next video of this particular module, because I'll be covering departmentalization in detail there, because departmentalization can be of many different kinds. Span of control is something that we've already discussed, the number of people who are reporting to the manager. Let me just go through it once more. Span of control or supervision means the number of workers reporting directly to a supervisor. Proper span of control is necessary for effective coordination and for getting better performance from the workers. If the span of control is higher, the organization structure of the company will be flat. Okay, as we've already seen in the flat organization, the span of control was more. When the span of control is narrow, then the hierarchy becomes a tall, it becomes a tall hierarchy. So let me just take you back. We have covered two principles so far: principle of specialization, principle of functional definition. Now we move on, and we've also covered the span of control, but we can come to this particular slide wherein we need to discuss what are the factors that influence the span of control. You understand what is span of control? What are the factors? One is managerial ability. If the manager is able to control more people, then the span of control would be wide. If the manager is not able to control more people, then the span of control would be narrow. Competence of the subordinates. If the subordinates who are working under you are competent, they are trained, then there are more number of people who can work under one manager. And of course, then that particular manager will have a wide span of control. If your employees or your subordinates are not well trained, then you will not be able to manage more number of employees. So when you're not able to manage more number of employees, your span of control would be narrow. Nature of work. If the nature of work is repetitive, that means you do not have to give instructions to your employees every now and then. So your nature of work also explains that what kind of a span of control you need to have. If it is repetitive, you are not giving instructions every now and then, that means you can handle more number of people, so your span of control would be wide. In case if it is that your work is not repetitive, it is that every now and then you have to give orders, so your span of control has to be narrow, because you'll be able to assist, or you'll be able to control only few number of employees. So when you are deciding upon the span of control in your organization, when you are developing or making the organization structure, then you need to consider all these things: managerial ability, the employees' capability, the nature of work. Based on that, you can decide that how many people would be reporting to the manager. Apart from that, there are two more factors that influence span of control: delegation of authority and degree of decentralization. Delegation of authority, let's just go through this. When the work is delegated to a lower level in an efficient and proper way, confusions are less. When the confusions are less, then of course the manager can control more number of people. So if you have a proper delegation of authority in your organization, everything, all the work is very easily, very nicely divided among people. So the manager becomes more capable of controlling more number of people. So the span of control becomes wide. And vice versa. If there is a lot of ambiguity in the organization, then the manager will not be able to control more number of people, and your span of control would be narrow. Degree of decentralization. If the manager has more power, he'll be able to control more people. So the span of control would be wide. As we had seen in the flat organization, if I take you back to that particular diagram, let me just show you again. See, here it is. When we talk about the flat organization, here what is happening is that your span of control is wide. Why? Because there's a lot of decentralization. Even the associate has a lot of powers. When we talk about the tall organization, the decentralization is less. Why? Because the power is only restrained to the top level management. That is the reason the hierarchy becomes tall and the span of control becomes narrow. So there are three things which you need to understand. Span of control, if it is narrow, the organization becomes tall. If the span of control is wide, the organization becomes a flat structure. When it is a flat structure, there is a lot of decentralization of power. When it is a tall structure, there is a lot of centralization of power. Why do we do a tall and a flat structure? Depends upon certain criteria which we were discussing, like managerial abilities, competence of subordinates, nature of work, delegation of authority, and delegation of centralization. So if your these things are clear, you will be able to understand whether that particular organization should have a flat structure or the tall structure. This is the same thing, narrow span of control, wherein you can see very few people are reporting to the manager. Only two people everywhere are reporting to the manager. So that means that these employees are not that capable. Even the managers are not capable of handling too many people, or it must be that the job is not repetitive. So narrow span of control, you have advantages and disadvantages. The advantages of narrow span of control is close supervision. Why? Because when you have narrow span of control, there are very few people who are reporting to you. So then you can supervise them very easily and very closely. You have a close control. You have fast communication between subordinates and superior. Disadvantages is that superiors tend to get too involved in subordinates' work because, you know, when there are few people whom you are controlling, at times it happens that you over-control them. And then you have a very tall hierarchy and high cost due to many levels. So then that is bad. So you need to understand and very clearly judge whether your organization needs a tall or a flat structure. Wide span of control, you can see that only one manager, there's so many people reporting to one person. This happens when? Because when there is a lot of decentralization, when the manager is capable of handling too many people, when the subordinates are well trained, when the work is not very, very changing frequently, it is kind of a repetitive work. Advantages, superiors are forced to delegate. Clear policies, subordinates must be carefully selected. So the span of control, when it is wide, it has a lot of advantages that, you know, it's not very time consuming when it comes to decision making because the decision doesn't have to travel through a lot of hierarchies. The hierarchy is less, communication time is less. Disadvantages is that there is tendency of overload superiors to take most or all the decisions. Why? Because there's so many people who are reporting to one boss, so of course he gets overloaded at times. Danger of superiors' loss of control requires exceptional quality of managers. The manager has to be really very good. It's only then that he'll be able to handle so many employees. Now when we talk about this is just a comparison of the tall and a flat structure, which I have already shown you through different various diagrams. This is again one slide which we can just go through. Factors determining the span of control. The incidence of new problems in a unit, if there are situations wherein new problems can arise every now and then of course the manager cannot handle too many things. So the span of control should be narrow. There should be less people who are reporting to the manager. Availability of plan of work, policies and standardized procedure. In case if the procedures are standardized, policies are being made, so of course the manager would be very easily, he'll be able to control the subordinates. Degree of physical distribution, nature of work, stability and complexity. So in all these things are something which the management has to keep or take into consideration while deciding whether the span of control of the organization has to be wide or narrow. So we've so far discussed three points, the fourth points, or you can say principles. The fourth principle is principle of scalar chain. Scalar chain, you can refer to the second bullet point. The scalar chain establishes the vertical graduation of authority and responsibility. Scalar chain is basically it helps in deciding the hierarchy as to who is reporting to whom, what is the communication channel for every department. Let's say if we talk about the HR department, you have a VP HR, you have maybe let's say a manager HR, assistant manager, executive. Now in these, this is a vertical hierarchy. In this vertical hierarchy, how the superior and the subordinate are communicating to each other is something which is called as a scalar chain. Scalar chain says that if there are let's say four levels, A, B, C, D in a department, then the communication should flow from A to B, B to C, C to D. Similarly, if we talk about top down, the communication should flow from D to C, C to B, B to A. It should not happen that the communication is directly coming from D to A and B and C doesn't know what is happening in the organization. So in case if such a thing is happening in the organization, then there will be a lot of ambiguity and the work would suffer. So let's just go through the bullet points. The first point says it refers to the number of levels in the structure of the organization, the chain of hierarchical command. The scalar chain establishes the vertical graduation of authority and responsibility. It helps taking decisions and communication is easy. According to this principle, the line of authority from top to bottom must be clearly defined to facilitate effective organization, because when the communication channel is well established, then there is there's less of miscommunication, there's less of communication gap, and the effectivity of the process and the different functions in the organization is better. The fifth principle is principle of unity of command. Unity of command says that there should be only one boss to which you have to report to. In case if you are reporting to two bosses, there would always be a miscommunication and a misunderstanding in the delegation of work. Let's just cover the first point. It implies one subordinate, one superior. Every subordinate is answerable and accountable to one boss at one time. This helps in avoiding communication gaps and feedback and responses prompt. Unity of command also helps in effective combination of resources, that is physical, financial resources, which helps in easy coordination and therefore effective organization. Unbroken line of authority that links all person in an organization is something which is covered under unity of command. So basically what you have to understand from this particular point is that every subordinate should be reporting only to one boss and not to multiple persons. Sixth point is principle of delegation. Delegation of work is very important. Work should be delegated and at the same time authority should be given to that person or to take certain decisions related to that particular work. When you're delegating the work should be clearly told to the person that this is what is supposed to be done. In case if there is miscommunication while delegating a work, again, the work would suffer. So the delegation process includes allocation of duties, delegation of authority, responsibility, and accountability. This is something that we've covered in the previous slide as well. Factors determining degree of authority delegation. Degree of authority is something that, you know, how much powers are you giving to your subordinates to take decision? That depends upon the organization size. If the organization is not too very big, then of course the top management can take decision. If the organization is very big and the top management wants to take decision for every little thing, it is not possible. Because for every decision, then it will take a lot of time. So if there are only 10 workers in the organization, of course the owner of the organization can take every decision. But then let's say if there are 200, 300, thousands of workers in an organization, then of course you need to delegate and you need to give authority at every level so that the people working at every level can take decision then and there. Importance of duty or decision. If that particular position is important and you think that the manager is capable of taking decision, you should give him authority. Task complexity. If the task is very, very complex of your subordinate and you think that that person will not be able to take right decision, you need to keep the powers with yourself. And in case if you think that that person will be able to take decision because the task is not very complex, then you can even delegate the responsibility and you can make that person accountable. Organizational culture, quality of subordinates, of course, is very, very important while deciding how much responsibility, how much powers, how much accountability, how much authority can be given to a particular person. I hope this thing is clear to you. This slide talks about degree of authority. How much power do you need to give to your people? So when we talk about delegation of authority, it is also talking about centralization and decentralization. In case if your subordinates are capable, organization is big, then of course you need to decentralize the power. When you decentralize the power, at every level decision would be taken. If the organization is small, you find your employees are not that capable, you keep the powers to yourself, and then it is called as centralization of power. Barriers to successful delegation: lack of superior's ability to direct the subordinates, lack of confidence in subordinate, and absence of control. In case of these things are there, then of course successful delegation will not take place. Major causes of managers' refusal to delegate. See, at times what happens, and is that even the superior doesn't want to give powers to the junior. Even if the junior or the subordinate is capable enough of taking decision, the superior keeps the power to himself. Maybe because of these 3 points: tendency to do things personally, desire to dominate, unwillingness to accept risk of wrong. If you think that, you know, it might be risky to give power to the subordinate, or you want, no, I need to dominate, I need to keep all the power to myself, then of course you will never give authority to the other person. Reasons for subordinates to avoid avoidance of accepting delegation. Maybe it can also happen that, you know, the subordinate doesn't want authority because the subordinate doesn't want to become responsible or accountable for a particular thing. So see, if we cover the points, decision making is a hard mental work and people seek ways of avoiding it. Fear of criticism, lack of necessary information, overload of work, and positive incentives may be inadequate. This is another point, principle of centralization and decentralization, which we've already covered, that you need to decide how much centralization of powers you want or how much decentralization of power you want. Let me just take you through the bullet points. Centralization: the degree to which decision making is concentrated at a single point in the organization. Top level managers make decisions with little input from subordinates. Decentralization is giving the powers to the subordinates. So the degree to which decisions are made by lower level employees. Distinct trend towards decentralized decision making. Factors that influence the amount of centralization and decentralization is something that we've covered, but let me just take you through this because it will make you understand the concepts better. More centralization. When do you want more centralization? When the environment is stable, lower level managers are not capable, lower level managers do not want to have a say in the decision. Decisions are very important. Organization is facing a crisis. Company is big. Effective implementation of company strategies depend on managers retaining say over what happens. So what is it when you do not want your lower level managers to take decision, you find them incapable, or the decision that is to be made is very, very significant for the organization, then you keep the power centralized to the top level management. When can we have more decentralization? When the environment is complex and uncertain. When the environment is uncertain, every now and then the top level management cannot take decision. Even the managers need to take certain decisions at certain time. So when the environment is complex and uncertain, then you have to give some kind of power to your subordinates. Lower level managers are capable. Lower level managers want to make decisions. Decisions are not that crucial. Corporate culture is open to allowing managers to have a say in what happens. Company is geographically dispersed. It is huge. It is dispersed. So not always that the top level management can take a decision. Geographically dispersed means it is widely spread over different areas. So then area wise, maybe the heads would take the decision. So with this, we have come to the end of this particular video. I just want you to see this particular slide, which was talking about the different principles which the management has to keep in mind while making the organization structure. It talks about specialization, functional division, definition, span of control, scalar chain, unity of command, delegation, centralization. I hope all these points are clear to you by the end of this video. I appreciate that you watched such a long video. Thank you so much for watching this video. I would suggest you to watch the next video as well, because it also talks about departmentalization and the types of departmentalizations which prevail in today's organization. Thank you so much.